So thank you for being with, thank you for joining, and you can start now, sir.
Thank you,
students, if you have any questions and any queries, you can ask at the end, or even you can post the message in the chat box.
Yes, shall I start?
Yes, sir, over to you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yes. Morning to all the participants. It's an each scale is as bank after a gap of the previous, as well as an opportunity for me to speak on such an important topic. So today we are discussing about important provision part to India, that is right to life and personal liberty, which is considered as the one of the most discussed provision history of Constitution of India from last 70 years. In fact, that is wrong for that matter, because I will be looking into that aspect in the beginning. So you just people should verify whether my screen is shared. Yes, I think the slides are visible, right?
Yes, sir, it is visible, sir.
Yes, sir. Okay, thank you. So right to life and personal liberty, which is considered as a right guaranteed in Article 21 of the Constitution of India. So let us start with a case before we proceed to the actual provision. The provision is very simple. In fact, you can notice if you look in the BER Act, the provision is short, but scope is so wide. Volumes of books are literature can be found on these two lines. The lines are which translate not any person, state not deprive to any person. Person shall be of his. Deprive to any person, state not deny to any person. The right to personal liberty cannot be denied except in accordance with the procedure established by law. That is what has been said by Article 21. Let us see the background and how this right as such was evolved and became one of the most widely interpreted right and widely interpreted provision in Part 3 of Constitution. So let us start with one famous case, that is A.K. Gopalan's case. That was the citation is AIR 1950, Supreme Court 27. This is the case. Its ratio was considered as a valid law for almost three decades. This
due to some internet connection, it got disconnected. He will be logging soon. Okay, A.K. Gopalan case, we usually discuss this case under Article 21, that is for right to life and personal liberty. Till the Menaka Gandhi's decision, we had this decision, as in it was holding good as a decision. But as soon as the Menaka Gandhi as a case has been decided, the scenario was totally changed. Okay, so that is what this case, and he will be dealing in detail as well. Okay, so
okay.
Ma'am, we will ask sir to switch off his video. If he switches off his video, I think bandwidth will be covered.
Phone maadi helde. So avrdu logout aag matte login aagtidare.
So let him rejoin and this time let him only present and talk, ma'am. I think the video is not necessary.
Haudu.
Since there is low bandwidth.
Helidini.
Yeah.
Helidini. I think login aadru. ಸರ್ ವಿಡಿಯೋ ತೆಗೆದ್ಬಿಡಿ ಸರ್ ವಿಡಿಯೋ ಇದ್ ಮಾಡ್ಬಿಡಿ ಸರ್ ಸರ್ ವಿಡಿಯೋ ತೆಗೆದ್ಬಿಡಿ ಸೊ ವಿಡ್ತ್ ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಇದು ಸ್ಪೀಡ್ ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಜಾಸ್ತಿ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ ಅನ್ಮ್ಯೂಟ್ ಅನ್ಮ್ಯೂಟ್ ಮಾಡಿ ಸರ್
ಎಸ್
ಎಸ್
ಸೊ ಸ್ಕ್ರೀನ್ ಇಸ್ ವಿಸಿಬಲ್ ನೌ ಮ್ಯಾಮ್
ನೋ ಸರ್ ನೋ ಸರ್
ನೌ
starting the screen.
Sharing is
yes, 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 sir. It is visible now.
Yes. So A.K. Gopalan's case is the leading case which held the field for almost 3 decades. Held the field for means, so this was considered as a valid law as far as its ratio is concerned. So what was the, what are the important principles of law laid down in this case? Let us have a look into that. So issues addressed by this case are this: whether Article 19, 21 and 22 are mutually exclusive and independent of each other. Even we can add Article 14 to that. So this was the important question which was raised by raised before this court, and on which the court gave its finding. And the Supreme Court in this case, they say that law said that they are mutually exclusive and independent of each other, having no link with each other. That being the case, you cannot find the validity or the constitutionality of Article 19 by keeping in mind or looking into Article 21 or vice versa. They are mutually exclusive provisions. And further, the court further held that law affecting life or personal liberty is not unconstitutional because it lacks natural justice or due process. This is the second important finding of Supreme Court in A.K. Gopalan's case. They say that law affecting life or personal liberty, which are considered as the important rights guaranteed under Article 21, so it can be denied. It can be denied with the help of law and a procedure prescribed by law. So whenever this being done, whenever our executive or the legislature is trying to affect our right to life and personal liberty, they need not follow the principles of natural justice. They need not follow due process. Of course, what is due process, we'll be discussing in the future. So this is the ratio of this case. So ultimately, what was the implication of this judgment of Supreme Court is this. They say that Article 21 says that, yes, you can, a state shall not deprive your right to life and personal liberty except in accordance with the procedure established by law. So that shows that law should be there and law should lay down a procedure. If these two things are satisfied, our right to life and our right to personal liberty can be denied. That is what the simple meaning of Article 21. So the court gave a very literal interpretation to this provision, and they say that once a law is made and the procedure is established by law, then you cannot challenge the validity of such a law by saying that there is no, they have not followed with the principles of natural justice or they have not followed the due process. That is what has been the interpretation given by Supreme Court in this A.K. Gopalan's case, and this was considered as valid for so many years in independent India, whereby we were just at the mercy of Parliament. If Parliament makes a law, even if law is not in accordance with the principles of natural justice, even though it is arbitrary, you don't have any recourse, you don't have any remedy, because law is there and procedure is there, and thereby your right to life and personal liberty can be denied. That was the position of law for many years, and no protection against competent legislative action. As I said, once a competent legislature has made a law, irrespective of not complying with due process, irrespective of complying with principles of natural justice, your right to life and personal liberty could be denied. That was the position of law according to A.K. Gopalan's case. And a person can be arrested without much procedural safeguards. Procedure should be there. Procedure need not be reasonable. That was the position as for A.K. Gopalan's case is concerned. Of course, A.K. Gopalan's case will be further in detail it will be discussed by madam when she starts her discussion on Article 22, that is on preventive detention. This law is basically, this case is basically connected with laws connected with preventive detention, but at the same time it had a great implication, or it has a great effect on even Article 21, because it's going to ultimately affect our right to life and personal liberty. So that is what has been said by Supreme Court in A.K. Gopalan's case, whereby the court gave very limited and narrow interpretation to the scope of Article 21, which was followed by still Meenaka Gandhi's case was decided by Supreme. So this is the background of Article 21. It is the
So in anything, yes, subjoined.
So pardon me for the problems. Because of the network issues, it gets disconnected often. There, because there may be some power also was not there. Now it has come back. So proceed. Is it okay if I proceed, ma'am?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Yes. So the moment we talk about Article 21, one important case which comes to mind of constitutional experts is that of Indira Gandhi versus Raj Narayan's case. So in fact, it is closely connected with Article 21 and 19 and 20. Article 19, 20 and 21. These are three important rights to which there is a direct link with this famous case, Indira Gandhi versus Raj Narayan's case. Why is? Because in that case, if at all you have studied other in other places, you could have known this facts. In this case, the election of Indira Gandhi from Uttar Pradesh was declared as illegal or made by the Allahabad High Court, and she was debarred from contesting elections for 6 years because of electoral irregularities and misuse of her official capacity. So ultimately, this judgment led to the imposition of emergency, and she made few important changes, and so many leaders of opposition were arrested without any reasonable ground, or not giving any reasons for why they have been arrested. Illegal arrests were made. A number of petitions were filed throughout India before different high courts. We call it as what kind of petition? That is habeas corpus petitions were filed before number of high courts. Almost 9 high courts gave judgment on the actions of the Indira Gandhi government, which authorized detaining a person illegally and denying him his right to life and personal liberty, which has been guaranteed under Article 21 during emergency. In all those, because of Indira Gandhi versus Raj Narayan's case, so this arrest, emergency came, emergency was imposed, and during emergency there were illegal arrest. So when this was challenged, ultimately in 9 petitions, almost 9 high courts, they declared that our right to life and personal liberty, that means illegally detaining a person without any proper laws or without any proper reasons, is violation of Article 21, and this right can be questioned before High Court as well as under Supreme Court under Article 32, under Article 32, even during emergency. That was the decision which was taken by almost 9 high courts in different parts of India. So they say that Article 21 cannot be suspended even during emergency. This was decided by high courts, but unfortunately, against these judgments of the high court, appeal was filed before Supreme Court, and this went before a constitution bench, and it was decided under the head, that is ADM Jabalpur versus Union of India's case, which is Shushukan Shukla's case. That is a very famous case again, which almost changed the course of Indian history. And unfortunately, the Supreme Court in this case has overruled the judgment of 9 high courts, which said that you cannot touch Article 21 even during emergency. State cannot do illegal arrest and thereby deny a right to life and right to personal liberty guaranteed under Article 21. Almost 9 high courts have given judgment, which were reversed by Supreme Court in ADM Jabalpur versus Shukan Shukla's case. So what was the observation made by Supreme Court in this case, in Shukan Shukla's case, was this. Yes, I think it's still Maintenance of Internal Security Act, which gave extraordinary power to the government to detain persons without trial. That was considered as illegal arrest. You have no remedy. That was the decision which was given by Supreme Court, overruling the judgments of all high courts, almost 9 high courts, which have given their judgment. So this was declared, or this has been described as a blow, bloody blow to the Indian democracy by the Supreme Court, because there were allegations that Supreme Court judges acted like a puppet in the hands of the then Prime Minister. Many allegations were made, and almost many judges who gave this judgment, they publicly apologized, saying that their decision in ADM Jabalpur's case was wrong. Ultimately, the main issue which was involved in this case is, can this Article 21 be suspended whenever emergency is declared? Emergency provisions we are going to study in your next semester. During national emergency, can this right to life and personal liberty under Article 21 be suspended? That was an important question which was raised in this case, and the High Court said that you cannot suspend it in the name of maintenance of internal security without trial or without any lawful basis. You cannot arrest. That was the decision of High Court, but this was overruled by Supreme Court, except a lone judge. I hope you, I think all of you must know the name of the judge and his background. That is H.R. Khanna. H.R. Khanna is the only judge who gave a judgment, a dissenting judgment, and said that Article 21 is sacrosanct. Article 21 and 22, these are the two important rights, that is right to life and personal liberty, cannot be denied even during emergency. Therefore, even if during emergency, if at all a person has been illegally detained and he has been arrested without trial, he can approach Supreme Court or High Court seeking his release. That is, he can file a petition for habeas corpus. So, this H.R. Khanna is the only person who said that, yes, it is correct. You cannot deny these rights even during emergency. Whereas other 4 judges in the constitutional bench, to name a few, Chandrachud, Justice Bhagavathy, and few more judges, they gave a judgment in favor of the then government. And they say that Article 21 gets suspended during emergency and you don't have a remedy. Anyone can be arrested and be kept behind the bars without trial, which was considered as a death blow to the very concept of democracy of India. But ultimately, you know what happened after this emergency. The government, Indira Gandhi, lost her power, and a Janata government was formed. And in this Janata government, they just brought one more amendment to the constitution, that is called as 44th Amendment. In the year 1978, 44th Amendment was introduced and was passed by the Lok Sabha, and that amendment brought important changes in Article 359. Please, all of you, make a note that Article 359 was amended through 44th Amendment, whereby it declared that the president, through notification, whenever emergency is declared, whenever national emergency is declared, the president can, through a notification, can suspend the enforcement of fundamental rights before High Court and Supreme Court, except the rights under Article 21 and 22. No, not 22, 20 and 21. fundamental rights guaranteed under Article 20, that is right against self-incrimination, right against double jeopardy, and those rights and right to life and personal liberty under Article 21. These two rights can never be suspended even during emergency. They are going to be there, and person who has been illegally detained can always approach High Court and Supreme Court and question the legality of such arrest. This is what has happened under Article under 44th Amendment, which has a great impact on the enforceability of rights guaranteed under Article 21. So this is the just a background of what Article 21 is. As I said, so Article 21, its scope was as defined by Supreme Court in A.K. Gopalan's case, saying that yes, your right is mutual exclusive, mutual right. Right is only a protection against executive actions. Government, I hope you know the concept of executive. Executive is the government. At the state level, we have state government, that is Chief Minister and his Council of Ministers, along with governor is the state executive. Central executive, it is President, Prime Minister and his Council of Ministers. So the right to life and personal liberties are protected only against the actions of this executive. Whereas legislature, if it makes a law and it lays down a procedure, your right to life and personal liberty can be denied. That is the implication of A.K. Gopalan's case judgment as such. So whereas this has changed drastically after the Menaka Gandhi's case. Menaka Gandhi versus Union of India, a very important case in the constitutional history of India. So where the Supreme Court for the first time overruled this A.K. Gopalan's judgment and gave new lease of life, or it tried to expand the scope of Article 21, and that the foundation, whatever has been laid down by the Supreme Court in that case, has its influence even today. Every now and then we can find new judgments being pronounced by the courts, Supreme Court and High Courts, broadening the scope of Article 21. How it all started and what are the important principles laid down in Menaka Gandhi's case, let us discuss. And one more thing I would like to inform you at the outset is that in this case, most of us will be under the impression that Menaka Gandhi was successful in this case, whereby she got remedy. In fact, it is not. In Menaka Gandhi's case, the judgment was against Menaka Gandhi, but in the course of giving the judgment, the Supreme Court laid down few important principles of law, which helped in broadening the scope of Article 21. What is that? What are those principles? We'll discuss. So Article 21 remained dormant for the 3 decades. It was brought to life by this judgment. Take it from me. As I said, A.K. Gopalan's case very narrowly interpreted Article 21, and it merely said that you cannot physically restrain, that is personal liberty, and you cannot be killed, that is right to life. If state cannot kill you, to that extent your right to life is guaranteed, and state should not physically restrain, that means state should not arrest you illegally without any law. That is the only protection which was given to Article 21 as per the interpretation given by the Supreme Court and what was being practiced in India for almost 3 decades after Constitution came into force. Article 21 remained dormant for 3 decades. This article was considered as not that serious or an important right. It was part of right to freedom. I hope you know that. Part 3, second important fundamental right is freedoms. Among the freedoms, most important freedoms were listed in Article 19, right to speech, right to freedom of speech and expression, association, movement, all these things are guaranteed there. And right of an arrested person is guaranteed under Article 20. Right of a person. So whereas Article 21 merely says that your life cannot be taken and your personal liberty cannot be denied. That was the very narrow interpretation which was given to this Article 21 till Menaka Gandhi's case. Whereas in Menaka Gandhi's case, everything changed. Let us see what happened. Article 21 remained dormant till Menaka Gandhi's case, and Article 21 became source of many substantive rights and procedural safeguards to people after this case was pronounced by Supreme Court. And Menaka Gandhi case overruled Gopalan's case, and it said that Article 14, Article 19, and Article 21 are not mutually exclusive. This is the most important finding of Supreme Court. They say that there is a link between Article 14, 19, and 21. They are linked. So for the purpose of deciding whether the procedure is proper, whether the law is reasonable to say that my right to life and personal liberty is denied, how to find out reasonableness? I have to go to Article 14, because Article 14 is something which tells as to what is reasonable and what is not reasonable. I hope you have already studied that. Article 14 permits reasonable classification but prohibits class legislation. At the same time, anything which is arbitrary is considered as bound to be affecting right to equality. So arbitrariness strikes Article 14. Therefore, whenever law says that through a law my right to life and personal liberties are denied, whether it is valid or not, whether it is reasonable or not, has to be studied based on the findings, based on the tests laid down by Supreme Court under Article 14. So there is a link between Article 14 and Article 21, as well as under Article 19, where they have laid down reasonable ground, reasonable restrictions, and only based on those reasonable restrictions, you can say whether my freedoms are violated by the state or not. So in this way, so the court, for the first time, it declared that Article 14, Article 19, and Article 21 are not mutually exclusive, they are interconnected. One is going to find justification through or in the light of the other. The court said that they strengthen each other. Article 14 strengthens Article 19 as well as Article 21. So they are a grand circle. They are circle. So ultimately, whenever you are doing something which is going to affect your right under Article 19 and 21, whether it is reasonable or not, should be found based on the principles laid down under Article 14, which talks about arbitrariness. Arbitrary actions can never pass the test under Article 14. It is violative of Article 14. That being the case, laws under Article 21, as prescribed laws, which can deny my right to life and personal liberty, has to pass the test of Article 14. This was for the first time laid down by the Supreme Court in Maneka Gandhi's case. So that's with respect to the important findings of this Maneka Gandhi's case. Of course, many more things were discussed. Basically, these are the principles laid down, which is going to have an impact on the scope of Article 21. Next important thing is scope of the term life was further broadened based on this Maneka Gandhi's judgment in different cases. What is that? The courts have declared that life is not confined to guarantee against taking away of life. It is something more than that. It is more than a mere animal existence. Just like as we take the life of animals, like that, if state takes away our life, then only Article 21 comes into picture. No, the court said that it is not so. The right to life is not just right to live like an animal. It is something more than that. That is what has been said by Supreme Court. The court in this Bandhu Mukti Morcha's case, based on the judgment of the Supreme Court in Maneka Gandhi's case, the court said that right to life includes right to live with human dignity and all that goes along with it, namely bare necessities of life, such as adequate nutrition, clothing, shelter, and facilities for reading, writing, and expressing oneself in diverse forms, freely moving about and mixing and mingling with fellow human beings. Look at the terms, the words which have been used by Supreme Court in Bandhu Mukti Morcha's case. The court said that right to life is not just like any other animal living in the village or in the forest. It is something more than that. Right to life includes right to get all the, lead the life with dignity. I have to lead my life. That is what is guaranteed. For which what is required? Bare necessities, which includes nutrition, clothing, and shelter, and all other facilities for reading, writing. That means it includes education. It includes freedom of expression, for which what is required. All these things are included in the right to life. And right to life is not just mere animal existence. It is right to live with human dignity. That is something that is guaranteed under Article 21 and not mere life of living like an animal. In this way, in this Bandhu Mukti Morcha's case, the Supreme Court tried to widen the scope of Article 21. Before proceeding further, one more thing which comes to our mind is transformation from what we say from 1 minute, I will just go to the slide. From procedure established by law to due process of law. That is an important change, key change which was brought by Supreme Court after Menaka Gandhi's case. That is an important question which was raised. Due process of law was a express, it was express, it is, which has been expressly provided in the US Constitution as a safeguard to right to life and personal liberty. What is this due process? Article 21 says that the state shall not deny to, a state shall not deprive to any person his right to life and personal liberty except in accordance with the procedure established by law. So there should be a law and there should be a procedure. And if these two things are there, yes, my right, my life and personal liberty can be denied. Whereas the important question which was raised is, should this law should be reasonable? Should that procedure also be reasonable? These things are to be looked into. So Parliament can make law. Parliament, whereby it can have a provision whereby the person's right to life and personal liberty can be denied. But whenever it is making a law, should it also pass the test of reasonableness? Should it also be intelligible? Such a, and should be fair? These are important questions which were raised. Shouldn't it not, can it be arbitrary or not? Should the principles of natural justice be followed whenever a law denies a person his right to life or personal liberty? These are important questions which were raised. And due process of law was considered as an integral part of Constitution of USA, whereas it was not so expressly stated in the Constitution of India. So what was done by Supreme Court in Menaka Gandhi's case? The court declared. So as it said earlier, the reasonableness, fairness, and non-arbitrariness is a fundamental feature of any state action. Whenever a state takes any decision, whenever Parliament makes any law, because Parliament is also a state within the meaning of Article 12, even if Parliament makes law, so it is an action of the state. It should always be non-arbitrary. It should always be reasonable. It should be fair. So whenever you are making a law which denies a person's right to life and personal liberty, you should also ensure that the basic principles of natural justice are to be complied with. Reasonable opportunity should be given to him to oppose his arrest or his denial of right. Whatever actions you take against a person, thereby you try to deny a person his right to life and personal liberty, you should give him reasonable opportunity to defend himself. And the law should be, as I said, you know, we know that under Article 14, we discussed about when we say something is reasonable. Reasonableness is there only when it is something is not arbitrary. Whenever something is being done arbitrarily, it can never be reasonable. So that test of reasonableness was included as part and parcel of Article 21. Therefore, due process has to be followed by Parliament also, not only executive, even Parliament, when if it makes law, it cannot just make a law which is unreasonable. It cannot just pass a law arbitrarily. It has to pass the test of reasonableness because due process of law was declared by Supreme Court impliedly as even is a constitutional principle which is equally applicable to India. And now it has been read along with right to life and personal liberty as defined under Article 21. Therefore, law is there through which you can deny a person's life and personal liberty, but that law should pass the test of reasonableness. Due process has to be followed even by those laws which deny me my right to life and personal liberty. In this way, there has been a transformation from a procedure established by law. It is not just a procedure. The procedure should be reasonable. It should follow the principles of natural justice. Due process, the process should be proper. Equal opportunity should be given to parties. And the conditions or the rules or regulations are to be reasonable. Then only we say that, yes, your law pass the test of a valid law under Article 21 because it has to pass the test of Article 14. So in this way, what the judgment has done is it put restrictions even on the powers of Parliament. Parliament can make laws, but not at the cost of this reasonableness. You cannot throw away the concept, the principles of reasonableness whenever making law, even though you have a power under Article 21. So from procedural aspects established by law to due process of law is an important and key transformation in the scope of Article 21, due to or from the date of pronouncement of the judgment in Menaka Gandhi's case. So this is with respect to procedural established procedure and due process. It is not just procedure, it should be due process, what is guaranteed under Article 21. So moving further, I think I have left a few more things in the previous slide. Yes, this is done. Liberty. So right to life is defined under Bandhu Mukti Morcha's case, saying that it is not a mere animal existence, it is something more than that. Moving further is liberty. What do you mean by liberty? Again, if you take into consideration A.K. Gopalan's case, liberty means free from physical restraint. I should not be illegally arrested. There ends the scope of my liberty. If at all I am not arrested, if I am not put behind the bars, there is no violation of Article 21. Whereas if at all I have been constantly watched, if at all my phones are tapped, there is no privacy for me. Is it not violation of my personal liberty? Can I freely move or can I freely act if at all I am constantly watched by someone? If at all my phones are tapped, can I speak to other people freely? These are not possible. But the A.K. Gopalan's case is that your right to personal liberty is confined to physical restraint. If at all I am not physically restraining you from moving, there is no violation of fundamental rights. Whereas this was not accepted by Menaka Gandhi's case and subsequent judgments, where they said that liberty is not confined to only physical restraint, but it is something more than that. What is that? We'll be discussing the term not confined to mere freedom from bodily restraint. Then what it is? So right to liberty includes liberty extends to a range of conduct which the individual is free to pursue. Look at this. Those words which have been used. Liberty extends to a range of conducts. What we can do as an individual is free to pursue. What we want to do freely. I want to move freely. I want to speak to you people freely. I want to have expression of what I feel on my Facebook, on my social media page. Again, I want to know information. All these things were considered as part and parcel of freedom, right to live. I want to know what has happened. That is a liberty. It is not mere physical restraint. How much of money, public money has been spent on a particular project. I want to know. I want to know is a free individual conduct which I can pursue. I want to know. So RTI, what we have today is the outcome of this. Wide interpretation which was given to this concept of life and personal liberty, whereby now RTI has become a reality now. So I can go and file an application and find and get to know how much money has been spent on the different things by using government exchequer, government funds. So how a person has been appointed, I can get an information. So like this, everything is now in the public domain. I can get information about all the activities of the state. It is just because of this widening of the scope of Article 21, that is right to life and personal liberty. So liberty extends to a range of conduct which the individual is free to pursue. Whatever I can do, which law does not prohibits for me from doing, to that extent I am permitted to do. That so for which what is for which there should not be any restrictions. If at all they tap my phone, I don't have a freedom to speak, that which I could have done. So like this, the scope of right to liberty has been widened, and the term personal liberty was narrowly construed as a mere freedom from physical restraint earlier was changed by this, and its expansion can be found in a number of cases. And one of the most important, the first case where this expansion could be observed is in Karak Singh's case. I hope you studied it in other places also, where a person has been under constant watch. He was accused of some offense and he has been arrested and he has been released now. Because of some other allegation, because of some doubts, what the police was doing, police was visiting his house in the midnight and just verifying whether he was in the house or not. And he was under constant watch. It was challenged as his violation of his right to life and personal liberty. The court said that yes, that doesn't mean that you cannot collect the information, you cannot collect intelligence. You can, but not like this. Of course, all our telephonic conversations were recorded, but they cannot be accessed or they cannot be used for every purposes. Only in extreme cases where the sovereignty of India was at issue, where there are some illegal activities are being carried out, then my conversations can be can be tapped, what we say, tapped, and my phone can be tapped, and the information can be extracted. Otherwise, for which there should be, there is a law which says that safeguards are there as to when a phone can be tapped. Sufficient procedural safeguards have been established whereby due process is being followed before my right to life and personal liberty being denied. So scope of this right to life and personal liberty was extended beyond imagination. This we can understand with the help of few key judgments which were pronounced by Supreme Court. Of course, we will not be looking into the facts of each of these cases. We will be concentrating or looking into the principles laid down as to what is the scope of right to life and personal liberty, which was laid down by Supreme Court in these different cases. First one is right to livelihood. Olga Tellis versus Bombay Municipal Corporation's case, the courts declared that right to life means not just right to live like animals, but it is right to livelihood. I hope you studied this this case. It is concerned with the people who are selling goods by the side of the road, street dwellers, so where they used to do trade and business on the footpaths of the road, they were asked to vacate. They challenged it. We are living because of this trade, like we could not do anything else. This is the means of our livelihood, and you are asking us to vacate. Where to go? Ultimately, they filed a petition. The court said that, have you made alternative arrangements, or the space are provided by the state where they can do their trade? If at all you have not done, then you don't have a right to vacate them. Even though the footpaths are not meant for the people to do business, but they don't have any other means of livelihood, therefore doing it there. You make alternative arrangements. Till then, you should not force them to vacate the places. So because the court said that right to life is not just to live, but even it includes means of livelihood. So right to life is read, and its scope was extended even to right to livelihood as a fundamental right. So that is what has been said in Olga Tellis case. Then further, right to reputation. State cannot, in the name of law enforcing law, it cannot play with the reputation of an individual. Right was considered as right to life and personal liberty. It is part of right to life and personal liberty under Article 21. It was so declared by the Supreme Court in State of Bihar versus Lal Krishna Advani, where the court said that right to reputation is also part and parcel of right to life and personal liberty. Moving further is euthanasia. I hope you studied a bit of this or know something. This is mercy killing, which is not yet being legalized in India in its fullest form. Only passive euthanasia is, to a limited extent, with so much of controversies, have been accepted in India. Euthanasia is right to die. So in connection with that also, few important questions were raised in Ratinam's case, which was again overruled by Supreme Court in Jian Kaur's case. These are two important cases which you should look into for having a better understanding of the scope of this case, and also regarding its link with Article 21. In Ratinam's case, the court said that right to life includes right to die. That means the provision under Indian Penal Code under Section 309, which deals with attempt to commit suicide, has been considered as an offense. Its constitutionality was challenged, saying that I have a right to life. Whether to live or not to live, it is my fundamental right, because right to life includes right to die. That was the argument which was put forward before the court in Ratinam's case. And ultimately, the court accepted the views, and the court declared that, yes, right to life includes right to die. Therefore, Section 309 of Indian Penal Code, which makes an attempt to commit suicide an offense, was unconstitutional, as it is violative of Article 21. And this holds good for almost 2 years till 1996, where again, in one more case, in Jian Kaur versus State of Punjab, AR 1996, Supreme Court 946, the same question was raised as to the constitutionality of Article 309, and the court reversed its own judgment. And the court said that no, right to life does not include right to die, because right to life is natural, a desire to live is natural, desire to die is unnatural. And the court said that right to life does not include right to die. Therefore, the provisions under Section 309 of Indian Penal Code is very much valid. And therefore, even today, attempt to commit suicide remains an offense in India. And euthanasia as such is not legalized in its fullest form. So these are few more dimensions as to what this Article 21 and its scope of right to life and personal liberty is. Further widening the scope of this right in death penalty by hanging was declared as valid, as considered as reasonable way of handling those rare cases where in the rarest of the rare cases you can award death penalty and a person can be hanged till he dies. These methods of taking life is considered as declared as valid in Bachchan Singh versus State of Punjab and also in Mithu versus State of Punjab. The court said that this taking away life by hanging a person till die is considered as a reasonable way of looking at dealing with this rarest of rare cases. Further expanding the scope of Article 21, we find many cases that is presumption of innocence, a fundamental right. That is that we say that a person till he is found guilty, the court should treat him as innocent. That was considered as a basic fundamental right under Article 21. It's part and parcel of right to life and personal liberty. There cannot be a presumption of guilt. Presumption of innocence was considered as a fundamental right in all cases. Next comes bail. Again, a number of cases were declared, they were decided by Supreme Court. Bail is a rule and jail is an exception. So whenever a person has been arrested, even though on an accusation that he is accused of committing a serious crime, still you have to show special reasons as to why that person should be contained, should be confined in the behind the bars, even though he is yet to be proved guilty or is yet to be convicted. So generally, bail has to be issued whenever there are no special reasons as to why he should not get the bail. There are, you will be studying in your CRPC as to the reasons to ask for custody, whether it is judicial or police custody. So there is possibility of destruction of evidence or him running away or his previous conduct. These factors are to be taken into consideration. But in general, what should be the rule? Bail has to be granted. If at all you are rejecting the bail, you have to give special reason as to why bail should not be given. So because bail, arresting a person or putting behind the bar is a serious encroachment on the right to life and personal liberty, which should not be done in every case or always. You should show special reasons as to why bail should not be granted. Otherwise, bail is the rule. You have to grant bail. So the right to livelihood, right to shelter, also considered as part and parcel of right to life and personal liberty under Article 21. And there are many. Supreme Court in Paramananda Katara versus Union of India. So let us take the current situation of getting vaccine for COVID. So it is part and parcel of medical care. I have to get the vaccine. That is considered as a fundamental right, right to life. Because without medical care, definitely my life will be under threat. So right to life is guaranteed means my right when I can lead a decent and dignified life, whenever I can get proper treatment. Because getting diseases or infecting with diseases or having health problems is so quite natural. But state has a responsibility to ensure that every person gets proper medical care. That is the duty of the state. And state, if at all state, could not ensure proper medical care to each person. I cannot say that you should get, everyone should get ICU treatment. If at all there is a requirement, even for which arrangements are to be made in the hospitals. Hospitals are to be there in sufficient numbers and sufficient number of staff and treatment facilities are to be made available by the government. Because right to medical care has been declared as part and parcel of right to life under Article 21. Further, health of labor has to be ensured. So keeping this in mind, many legislations have been passed by the parliament to take care of the health of laborers who are working. Of course, we have many labor laws which you have been studying. Take, for example, Factories Act. And many other legislations where they have said that measures are ESI Act. Why these legislations have been made? Because even laborers are going to work, even their health is of great importance. And sufficient safeguards should be taken by the state to ensure that their health is protected, because health, having a good health is part and parcel of right to life. Therefore, we have so many legislations which are trying to ensure that the laborers are going to be at good health. So in this way, it has been interpreted as part and parcel of right to life. So then sexual harassment, prevention of sexual harassment at workplace. Men, women should not be exposed to the risk of being sexually harassed, for which sufficient safeguards to be made, sufficient arrangements are to be made to prevent sexual harassment, was read as part and parcel of right to life and personal liberty, because right to live a dignified life means women should be in such a position that there should be sufficient safeguards for her against the possible sexual harassment. Then right to privacy. Karak Singh's case, the court said that right to privacy, and even in this Govind versus State of Madhya Pradesh, AR 1975, Supreme Court 1378. In this case also, the Supreme Court has expressly stated that right to life and personal liberty includes right to privacy. Even though we don't find anywhere in Part 3 of the Constitution the word privacy, but it has been so interpreted that it is part and parcel of right to life and personal liberty. So right is limited, restricted, and it can be restricted in public interest, but you have right to privacy as such. If at all it has to be denied, there should be a procedure established by law, and the procedure should be reasonable. Otherwise, your right to privacy cannot be denied, or your right to privacy cannot be interrupted, or others cannot interfere in your life without proper reasons or without proper basis, even by state. So in that way, even right to privacy has been declared as a fundamental right. And environment, of course, you'll be studying in your final year as an entire chapter dedicated for constitutional safeguards to environment. So there were many principles were laid down by Supreme Court saying that wholesome environment free from pollution, an environment which is going to expose us to the risk of health hazards, such an environment should not be there. So ensuring that a wholesome environment is a part and parcel of our fundamental right. So we have fundamental right means who has a duty? State has a duty to ensure that our environment is free from pollution. So many judgments were given by Supreme Court, whereby different principles were read as part and parcel of our legal system. The most important means sustainable development and precautionary principle, public trust doctrine, polluter should pay principles. All these principles, which are considered as the foundation of environmental law today in India, they can find their roots in the interpreting the scope of right to life and personal liberty. In this way, the scope of Article 21 is kept on being expanded by Supreme Court through these different judgments. Then noise pollution in reference case. A reference was made regarding the noise pollution. The court has expressly stated that using of loudspeaker by religious institutions is violation of right to life and personal liberty. Whether I should hear something or not, I should have freedom. No one should impose his will on me saying that I am going to use loudspeaker and render prayers or play music. Whether you want it or not, you have to listen to. No. No one can impose on me as to what you should listen. Noise pollution is going to be adversely affecting my right to life and personal liberty. So it was considered as, if at all there is noise pollution is allowed, it is violation of fundamental right to life and personal liberty. In this way, the scope has been expanded, and even HIV positive persons' rights have been recognized, and the courts have made, in many judgments the courts have declared that even their right to life and personal liberty has to be respected, and their details of these people about HIV positive people should not be disclosed, they have to be kept secret. But at the same time, there are a few cases where in Mr. X versus Hospital Z, it was decided in year 1999, Supreme Court 495, important questions were raised as to this issues. Can a doctor disclose to the fiancé the HIV positive status of the other person? The court said that yes, in those cases, the doctor can disclose the status, because it's a matter of her or the other person's fiancé's life. So to protect that, if at all you have disclosed the HIV positive status of the person who is going to be married, so then definitely it was considered as valid and it is not a violation of right of right to life and personal liberty of this person. In fact, it is the right to life of that fiancé who is about to be married to HIV positive persons. His right to life is saved, but that extent is considered as valid. So further, fair trial is also declared as a part and parcel of right to life and personal liberty. Fair trial and speedy trial. So speedy trial has been declared as a fundamental right under Hussain Ara Khatun versus State of Bihar. So in this regard, directions was given to the government to establish more number of courts and to have more number of judges. Vacancies are to be filled, and even the procedures are to be so modified as to ensure that speedy justice, fast track courts were established, and the courts have been state governments have been asked to establish more number of courts and thereby ensure speedy trial, because speedy trial was also declared as a basic right and it is read as a part and parcel of Article 21, right to life and personal liberty. Because denial of justice or justice delayed is considered as justice denied. So ultimately, I am entitled to justice because of the delay in the proceedings. If at all I could not get what I am entitled to, that itself is violation of my right to life and personal liberty. In that sense, the term right to life and personal liberty has been so widely interpreted. Further, bail, IBDB discussed, more criminal courts we discussed, legal aid. A person, irrespective of his capacity to pay to his advocate, once a person has been facing some legal problems, getting a legal aid has been declared as his fundamental right, because it is also considered as a part and parcel of right to life and personal liberty. This has been so declared by Sukhdas versus Union Territory of Arunachal Pradesh in those days. Now it is a state, AR 1986, Supreme Court 991. So in this way, and handcuffing of 100 trials was also declared as violation of Article 21. Unless there is a special reason, merely because a person has been accused, has been under trial, there is no need that there should be handcuffing. He should be allowed to have a free walk. You cannot put so much of restraint on a person. It violates his personal liberty. So there should be guidelines as to when there can be a handcuffing. Merely because he's under trial, there is no need to put him into so much of restraint by handcuffing. So the court said that it is violation of his right to life and personal liberty. Right to upliftment and dignified life for prostitutes was also declared as a right to life and personal liberty. It is part and parcel of right to life and personal liberty for upliftment and dignified life for prostitutes, because they have been socially outcasted people. They were not given any respect. So these are some serious problems which are faced by prostitutes. So even measures are to be taken for their upliftment and to bring them to the mainstream is a responsibility of state, and it is a right of those prostitutes to have a dignified life and upliftment, for which measures are to be taken by the state so that they can also lead a dignified life. That is considered as part and parcel of right to life and personal liberty. So this is how, in the limited time, I could just give an overview of the scope of Article 21. And if at all there are any questions, they can raise. Sir, ma'am, it's over to you.
Vivek, sir.
Yes, sir. Good afternoon. Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
Sir, there are a few questions which I will raise.
Yes.
I'm on the behalf of the students which have come.
Yes.
So the first question is, do you think because of K.S. Puttaswamy judgment, the right to privacy judgment, the scope of 21 has been enhanced too much?
Look, ultimately, whether it has privacy, it's a scope, it depends on the perceptions of us. We cannot say, look, one basic thing what we should understand in law is that we will not be in a position to decide whether it is right, whether expanding it is right or wrong. It's a different issue. Puttaswamy decision judgment has definitely expanded the scope of right to privacy. Definitely it has expanded. Now, whether it is right or wrong, It depends on the perceptions. Few people say that because of these reasons, it is right. Few people say that this is, it is too much is being done, whereby it creates other problems. So it's Supreme Court felt that this is what is considered as correct. So they have given the judgment. So it's, and we know that in jurisprudence we study, there are no ultimate rights and ultimate wrongs. So things are going to happen as an, it's a, it is a stage. As I said, as long as A.K. Gopalan's case was valid, the judgment, the scope of Article 21 was very limited. So it's just a stage. In the course of time, definitely we may find it's a dialect. It moves on. As of now, Puttaswamy judgment is considered as valid for now. Tomorrow, we may find out some of the problems which may be created because of so much of expansion of the right of privacy. Then we, law itself is going to find, or the society itself is going to find a solution to modify Puttaswamy's judgment and put in place few safeguards so as to people may not be in a position to misuse it. So it's an ongoing process which continues. As of now, as we as a law graduate, or we as a student of law, we are not in a position to declare what is law or what is right and what is wrong. And none of those judgments, even for that matter, Keshavananda Bharathi's case, which has been considered as something which could not be changed in the near future, but we don't know what is going to happen. So Puttaswamy's judgment, it is a phase, as there are so many changes are happening in the world, especially in the technical world. So internet has brought it so close to us. So it's a transition stage where they felt that the judges, they felt that this is what is the need. So they have pronounced the judgment. So tomorrow it may change.
The second question is very interesting, sir.
Yes.
They're asking, has right to life and liberty created positive rights to citizens under fundamental rights?
So that is the problem. So, in fact, I come across with one famous writing by a famous advocate from Supreme Court of India. I forgot his name. Regarding this Hoffeld's analysis. I think those who studied jurisprudence, they know.
I think Arvind Dattar.
Arvind Dattar has written an article as to the way in which our Supreme Court itself has misunderstood this this concept of right and its scope, even reservation for that matter. We consider is a reservation as a matter of right. Correct. In fact, these are negative obligations. The problem lies is that, so these fundamental rights are as it is. They are restraint on the state. State should not do these things. These are negative obligation not to do. These are negative rights of us. Whereas in the hope, I don't know to what extent I am right, but it has been widely discussed in other parts of the world, parts of the in the legal field. I am saying that judges were in a hurry. There are few people are saying, especially after emergency. And because as I noted one important case, ADM Jabalpur's judgment, whereby Supreme Court was discredited, saying that it has become a puppet in the hands of the executive. That was what happened. And you just go, people go to Sirwai's book, Sirwai's commentary on constitutional law. Sirwai has explained how judges were there, what kind of judges they are. In fact, two chapters were dedicated to say, to tell us as to why they should not have become judges of Supreme Court. So because of these reasons, what happened? So that this is one part of the story. I'm not saying that it is the right approach, but one group of people or one way of thinking is that in their urge, in their, what we say, are in their efforts to prove themselves to be independent and to come out of the stigma of emergency, because everyone criticized those four judges who gave judgment in ADM Jabalpur's case. They're saying that you people have become puppets. Every judge, including the then Chief Justice of India, A.N. Ray, was criticized, almost saying that he has become a puppet of Indira Gandhi. So those judges who have lost their face because of ADM Jabalpur's judgment and subsequent judgments, even in Minerva Mills case, those who know about Minerva Mills case, they wanted to blindly support government just to please their masters. So they wanted to come out of the stigma. They did too much by expanding Article 21 to unimaginable extent. One view is that people criticize that it's not going to make sense. Our judges have lost the basics. That is one argument Arvind Dattar has given, saying that why the basic thing which should have been understood by a student of law in his law college when he studies Hoffeld's analysis, and they misinterpreted. This is not right and duty. These fundamental rights are not positive duties. They are negative duties to protect ourselves from the excesses of state, because state is all powerful. If it do something which is not going, which is going to affect my basic civil and political rights, I will be helpless. Therefore, I need protection. With that noble objective, the concept of human rights, the concept of fundamental rights came. Whereas, huge. I am not saying it. It is my view, but many people say this. Judges have done too much by declaring this right to life and personal liberty as positive duty of the state. In fact, if you read it as it is a negative duty. Negative duty not to deny you your right to life and personal liberty. That means, of course, up to the extent of due process. If you ask me personally, up to the extent of due process of law has to be followed, even though when you are denying your right to life and personal liberty, to that extent it is right. Beyond that, saying that you have to provide a wholesome environment, you have to provide livelihood to what? And if at all you keep on stretching this, where is the end? That's one more. This is one side of the argument. That's all. I'm not saying this is the correct one. This is one way of thinking. Yes, as your friends have raised the question, definitely there is a section of thinkers who feel that so much of stretching the scope of Article 21 may lead in the future to quas. That's possibility. Yes.
So I think there are still questions flowing, but due to paucity of time, we'll take a stop at this point of time.
Yes.
And I would really thank you for the wonderful time which you took out and gave a lecture on life and liberty, which I think is a central scope of our constitution. In fact, if you look into our constitutional assembly debates, as you have highlighted, that this forms the central fulcrum of whatever happens. Life and liberty, even during emergency, has to be protected. I would take this opportunity to propose my vote of thanks, first of all, to our principal, sir, J. Mallikarjuna, Dr. J. M. Mallikarjuna, sir, to providing us this platform to conduct and to initiate such kind of more and more guest lectures. Thank you, sir. To our IQAC coordinator, Manoj, sir. Most importantly, to the coordinator of this event, Sharda ma'am, for taking up efforts to ensure that the students not just listen to her, but also to revered professors coming from other places also. Thank you, ma'am. To our technical support, which is always provided by our Tanmay, sir. I would deeply thank Tanmay, sir, for providing the technical support. And most importantly, I would also thank all the student participants who have actively listened and also asked questions and engaged with, sir. Thank you, sir. Thanks, sir.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much to Sharda ma'am. And thanks to principal, sir, for giving me this opportunity to give a lecture to students of my own college, where I taught for so many years. It's a wonderful opportunity. Thanks to everyone. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much for being with us for 1 hour. Thank you so much, sir. We look forward for more lectures like this.
Yes. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Ma'am, shall I end the program?
Yes.
Yeah. Yes. Thank you, ma'am.